I don't remember if I've done this video before. This is from 2 weeks ago. Tim Kaine. He's sort of a big deal. He wrote video games back in the day. I think he still does. He consults or something. Anyway, what is the best operating system for game development?
Hi everyone, it's me, Tim, and today I want to talk about the best operating system to make games for.
Oh, that's different. Okay, your title said best OS for game development. Now you're saying best OS to write games for. That's two different things. In theory, you can design a game on a Macintosh and then push it out to window players. Or program something on Linux and push it out to all the Cray supercomputer users out there. There's a few left.
Now, this is an answer to a question that Rami Obam asked, which is, hey Tim, can you please talk about the best OS to use in your experience for programming and designing? Does it even matter for the user in those professional grounds? Yes, but I'm not going to talk about what I think the best one is to be doing that work in, because that's subjective. Some people like Mac OS, some people like Windows, some people like Linux.
I like Windows. But that's because Windows 95. I liked Windows 95 better than Mac at the time. What was it, System 7? I never liked the operating system for the Mac. The one button mouse thing? Nope. No, thank you. When I was doing Unix, I had a one button mouse. No, thank you. I had come from Unix. I didn't like Unix anymore. I'd given up on it. I thought, you know what? I'll just go with the McDonald's operating system called Microsoft. It worked. Once in a blue moon, I'd get the blue screen of death, but only because I deserved it. I was doing something I knew was not copacetic, so. And I could read the error message on a blue screen of death, so I knew what the problem was. Most people get the blue screen of death and they're like, oh no. But the message, it's telling you in the blue screen of death why the game, why the computer crashed for real. So, once you find out what's causing the blue screen of death, you fix your computer or you fix the driver and it doesn't happen anymore. Now, the beauty with Unix at the time was you could install it, run it on a computer. You could leave the computer running for 10 years without ever rebooting it or doing anything. It would still be running after 10 years. So guess what people would do? They would put a mailing list kind of thing, an interest group, Usenet, something people could subscribe to with email. This is back in the 90s. And if you messed up your server, let's say you formatted the hard drive or whatever, thinking, oh, I'm going to reinstall Linux and something else, Slackware or Red Hat or whatever on this thing. The people that were subscribed to to your user, your, what was that called back then? It was just Usenet, I guess. That would be gone. So you'd have to do some tinkering to get that working again. I remember calling up, the reason why I know this is because I remember calling up Sun Microsystems, asked them how to get that going again. Anyway, they were fun. I lived just a few miles from them at the time, so I could just drive over there. That was near, what was that near? That was near, none of that's there anymore. It's all gone. All that stuff's been bolted. Microsoft used to be right across the street from Apple, and then Microsoft and Sun Microsystems were next door to each other. Oh, that was a great thing. That was a great time. Good times. It's all gone now.
And there's a million OSs out there. I'm going to answer in terms of pure practicality. In other words, what should you know how to program in to make games? And that is Windows. And the short of it is,
it's everywhere.
If you know Windows programming, that gets you access to the PC market and the similar Xbox market, which is a big chunk of the market and has been for decades.
Yeah.
All you have to really do is additionally learn PlayStation, and you've got a, most of the market right there. Now, that also presupposes.
What about iOS? We don't want to write games for iOS. Swift. Don't we want to program in Swift? Now, apparently, well, this only works for six. You only have a 6-month window to do this in. And that's when you can write code on a Windows machine and it runs on a Macintosh. Or you could write software on a Macintosh and it works in Windows. But you only have 6 months to do this in. Because these tech partners, when be leery of tech partners. When Microsoft announces, we have a new tech partner, and they release a new version of their IDE and GUI and compilers and all this stuff, just when they say they have a tech partner, that lasts 6 months. Because in 6 months, either Windows will get an update, the a new editor will come along with new plugins, so everything gets updated. Or on the Mac side, Mac is gloriously famous for doing this. And that is, every 18 months they'll release a new operating system that basically forces you to rebuy all your software. You just can't run your you can't run your existing Apple software on your new Mac. Isn't that crazy? Isn't that crazy? I think it is. My Windows 11 computer is still running assembly language crap I wrote in the mid 90s. That's insane. Something I wrote for like a 386. 60 megahertz, 380, no, it was like, it's like a, back then it would have been maybe 20 megahertz, 25 megahertz, 386. That software runs just fine on Windows 11 i9. It just works. No, the screen is like this big, though. It's like 640 by 480 is like that on my screen. It used to be like this, then it was like that. You know, every time I get a bigger monitor, that little window gets smaller and smaller.
Poses that you're going to learn some type of C language, so you can know C++ and C#, but I'm only going to talk about OSs. Now, you did say in my experience, so let me walk you through all the OSs I've used and why they didn't make the cut.
Some people say write in Java, it'll run on anything. I don't know if that's still true, but I remember that was a thing. I think the only thing, I want to say the only thing you can run on all the computers, if you think of, they've banned it now. But Shockwave Flash, you could run that on anything. The browsers just ran it. I guess it'd be JavaScript. Is it JavaScript now? As long as everyone has an updated web browser, they can run JavaScript just fine on anything.
So way back in the late 70s, I started on the Atari. I couldn't remember what the name of the OS.
400? Oh, there was no OS on those things. What? Oh. Well, you said 70s. Atari 400 or 800 maybe. was there was a disk. There was a disk thing that you had to do. It was like Commodore. It was like the Commodore 64. You had a disk and you just typed, oh, it would just say okay and you'd say run or load or something. It had a disk operating system. All that means is the computer could save files on a floppy disk. That was about it.
OS was. So I looked it up and Wikipedia listed as default OS. I don't think they called it anything.
No.
It was just, or they called it DOS, which is weird.
Disk operating system. Yeah, there's TrisDOS, which was the Trash 80 DOS. And then there was RS-DOS, which was Radio Shack DOS. And then there was Apple DOS. But what did the Commodore call theirs? C-DOS or something? C64 DOS? DOS Commander. I mean, they have these fancy names. And then on the Z80 side, you had CPM. On the TRS-80 side, you had SuperDOS, LDOS. And then on the... Oh, what were those other computers called? The Heathkit H8, H9. What were those things? Did they have an operating system? I think it was just disk operating system. You know, these machines only had 4K at the most. Not much of an operating system. You need at least 8K if you're going to be doing an operating system.
Weird, because that became what the IBM one was called. But under Wikipedia, or under the Atari, I learned under their OS to program BASIC and assembly.
Yep.
And that let me do a lot of stuff right there. I basically did things in BASIC, except for the things that...
6502, though. So I skipped the Atari and the Apples because they only had 6502s in those things.
Had to be an assembly, either because that was the only way to access it, or if you really needed speed, assembly. Their player missile graphics were a good example of, you really wanted to do that in assembly. Then, very shortly after that, I jumped into DOS because I got a job.
Yeah, games like Missile Command, Defender, you know, the Pac-Man, Centipede, Tempest, Lunar Lander, Asteroids. Even the more advanced games like Harrier Fighter. The Sega games, Outrun. Those you just had to do those in assembly. There was just no way around it if you wanted fast graphics.
At a game company when I was 16, and I was doing tools for them on the Atari, but they were going to make a game, which turned out to be Grand Slam Bridge, on the PC under DOS. So I quickly learned DOS. We made Grand Slam Bridge under DOS.
Yeah, you can learn DOS in like a day. If you stay up all day and just cram, you can learn DOS in a day. It's not much different than CPM.
And this is where I learned an interesting thing about DOS. You can do anything you want, but you have to do everything.
Yeah.
Everything you want, you have to do the things you don't want to do.
Yep.
Basically, it doesn't really give you much. Oh, you want a pop-up window? Code everything about that.
Yep. The Tandy color computer was the same way. Want to make a GUI? Sure. Here's how you program the computer. Because, you know, you would turn on these computers, right? Back in the day, early 80s, you'd turn these computers on and they would stare at you. Or is it ready or okay? Or it would have a C colon greater than or slash or something. With a cursor just waiting for you to type. So every time you turned on your computer, you had to type in a program from scratch, unless you had it saved on cassette. Now the IBM PC had used PC DOS, and it used cassette tape briefly. Eventually, it came out with floppy drive and then hard drive and stuff. The IBM clones, when you would fire those up, if you had no hard drive, See, on an IBM PC, if the computer detected you had no drives, no hard drive, no floppy drive, it would start up BASIC, and you would just be on the screen. BASIC, I think that's what it was called. Basically, it was like, it was the IBM version of Microsoft BASIC. Bill Gates wrote that for the PC. So the clones, the IBM clones, didn't come with BASIC built into the computer. So when you'd be putting together, put together an IBM clone back in the early 90s and late 80s, you know, people would buy motherboards and memory and CPU and case and power supply and fan and all that stuff, keyboard and monitor, go home, put their computer together. They'd always bring the computer back to the store saying, "This is broken, it's not working." I would try to get these people a call first before they bring their computer to the store. Technically, you want them to bring the computer to the store because you can charge them to fix it. But when you only have two techs and you're taking care of all the computers, all of them, it gets overwhelming. Sometimes you can just quickly tell them over the phone how to fix it. It's less frustrating for the end user, because they would call and they would say, I would say, "What's on the screen?" And they'd say, no ROM BASIC found." So that means it did not detect the drive on their computer. So it tried to boot up into BASIC, and there's no BASIC on a motherboard made from Malaysia. It's just not a thing. So that's what that message would mean. So in a few minutes, you can get them to explain what jumper settings you have on the hard drive. Is it plugged into which IDE port was it plugged into? That kind of thing. And then, boom, it would come up with another message. Something similar, but it would give you a clue that hard drive found, it sees the hard drive, but now you just have to run fdisk to partition the drive and format it. Then you're good to go. Anyway.
From scratch. Oh, you want a new font? Do it by hand.
Yeah. I was at a friend's house. Okay, I used to go to Beagle Brothers. In San Diego, there's a place called Beagle Brothers, and they wrote all the Apple software. And I would ride my bike there. Check out their whatever stuff they're doing. It's Beagle Brothers. It's really, they might still have an ancient website called Beagle Brothers. Anyway, a friend of mine had an Apple, and he would buy their stuff, and he'd show it off. "I have an Apple. You should come to my house. I have an Apple, and I'm using the latest Beagle Brothers such and such." I'm like, okay, whatever. So I look at his program, his newfangled program he got for $19.95. It was a font editor. You can make your own fonts for the Apple II computer. So I'm watching him use it and stuff, and I'm like, huh, that's neat. And the program was written in BASIC. So I looked at the code briefly, and I'm like, oh, I hate the Apple. Anyway, so that night, I go home, and after, you know, watching him struggle making fonts on that thing, I don't know why he was making fonts, but I needed fonts for video games I was making for the Color Computer 2. Yeah, the Color Computer 2. So when I got home that night, I started programming exactly the same thing on the Color Computer 2, and by... I think I stayed up all night. I had to go to school the next morning. Anyway, I was like dead tired. But one more night of that, and I had it down pat. I had not the exact carbon copy version, but I had a font editor on the Color Computer 2. And My friend had printed out some of the sample fonts that came with the program. And back then I didn't know how to convert Apple. We didn't have Kermit or Z term or X term or whatever. I didn't have any terminal software yet. I don't think I had a modem yet. But he printed out the fonts, and because I wouldn't know how to read an Apple disc in a Radio Shack floppy drive controller. Anyway, so he prints out the fonts. There's like four or five of them, and I meticulously created each font on my color computer too, just by counting the dots that would make each letter. And I had the dots on the screen, you know. I was doing upper and lower case because the Radio Shack computer only did upper case. It didn't do lower case. But my fonts could do lower case. Ooh. With the descending G and the Y. Ooh. So I was writing text adventures for the color computer 2. Then later on for the color computer 3. So if it was a sci-fi game, I would use the sci-fi font from Rollerball or from Soylent Green. Then Traveler would come out. You know, I'd look at there was some version of Traveler that came out. I can't remember now what it was. And it had the font, and I'm like, okay, let's put that font in there. Why not? I can't remember now what it was. Maybe it was Mega Traveler. That would have been years later, though. So, in summary, to summarize, when you turned on these computers, they would stare at you. You had to do all the work. So, yeah, also on that same computer, I wanted a GUI. So, guess what? You have to write a GUI from scratch. I want to use my mouse. Oh, you get to write a routine that makes the mouse cursor move around on the screen. From scratch. Oh, it was fun. Would I do it again? No. When Windows 95 came out, I threw all that stuff away. Threw it all away. Went to the dumpster. Yep. And because Windows 95, basically someone at Microsoft played around with all the operating systems, GUIs, all the GUIs that came with all the OSs. They played around with them and stole the best ideas and made Windows 95. I was like, whoa, this is way better than X Windows. This is better than Solaris. This is way better than the System 7 Multifinder. This is way better. You know, it was just better. It was better than, what was there? It was Geo something or something. It was either Geo or Gem, something Gem, or some of the Atari 512 ST used something. Maybe it was called Gem, or maybe it was the Atari, one of those guys. They used Gem, Geo something, Geo, can't remember. There was like before 95 really took off, there were a handful of competitor GUIs that you could run on IBM clones. Some of them are good. They developed themselves during Windows 3.1. But then Windows 3.1 became Windows 95. And those other GUIs never caught up. Everyone just adopted 95. The ipso facto. I tried to program in 95. I could not handle it. I had all the books. I mean, I could do it. I didn't like programming for Windows 95. I did not. The way they label the variables, Visual Basic. I was using Visual C, Visual Basic. Didn't like either one of those environments. didn't like programming in either one of those languages. Because I had come from Unix, which had the best BASIC ever. And then I come to Windows 95, and it has QBASIC, or QuickBASIC, or something. Or BASIC-a. There was GWIS BASIC. Different BASICs. I want to say Windows 11 comes with a BASIC. I haven't even looked yet. That'd be weird if it did. I know I have the outsourced, they call it open source, but it's really outsourced. The DOS box, whatever, it runs 64-bit BASIC for DOS or something. That way you can still run. I can run all my old games like Tomb Raider from 95, you know, that kind of stuff. Games written for DOS/Windows, you can still run those things. But I hated programming. I hated programming for DOS. Hated programming for Microsoft BASIC. So I didn't program. I didn't program for, from 90. From 95 until 2006, I wasn't programming at all. Something happened in 2006, and that was Python 2.5. Python 2.5, I call it classic Python now. That was my go-to language. Now I'm using Python 3, Python 3.11 right now. Still my go-to language for everything.
It's an interesting thing that DOS was so basic. Basically, it's a very thin layer.
Yes.
Over just what the chips on that motherboard chips provide to you.
You guys say chips. There is no layer. There's no seven layers of heart of infrastructure between what you're programming and the nuts and bolts. No, you're doing peaks and pokes directly into the CPU, basically.
Very thin layer. So you have to do everything. I went off to college while I was working on Grand Slam Bridge. And the college I went to, University of Virginia, used an OS called PrimeOS. PRIMOS. Looks like Primos, the band, or Primus, or whatever. But it's pronounced Primos. And it was on their Prime computers. So while I was in college,
oh, the Prime.
This was in the mid-80s.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, San Diego State had Prime. And they had a VAX. Most people use the VAX, though.
80s. I learned a lot of different flavors of Unix, which is what Primos was kind of like. It was also a weird mixture of DOS and Unix, but it was more like Unix. And we used those. They were basically microcomputers hooked up to a mainframe. Because I was at an engineering school with getting a computer science degree, in addition to learning all the hardware stuff, they tried to teach us a wide variety of languages. So in addition to C, which I already knew.
Fourth,
in fact, Lisp. I could tell a whole story about
Pascal,
something that happened to me in a COBOL. C class there. I'll save that for another video. I also learned Pascal, which I had already kind of learned in high school from the one computer science class my high school taught. We also learned Prolog, Snowball, Fortran, Lisp, just a all wide variety of languages.
Yeah,
and that's
like,
where we learned different.
When you went to computer science, there was like 8 languages. You only need to know 2 of them. I would want to know all of them just because. Somebody said, take Lisp. That's what they use for AI. Like, okay, I want to do AI. That was insane. Lisp was insane. It was a cool language. Would I use it though? No. It was a fun, it's an academia. It's a language used in academia. And once you're outside of academia, when you're no longer a professional student, it's like, why do I have this program? Why do I have these books? I still kept my Lisp, my Addison Wesley books. There's like 4 of them for Lisp and artificial intelligence from 1984. I'm sure they're so outdated, but I'm sure they're still relevant. Because computers haven't really changed. Computers are just faster now. But I remember in the book, there was the problem. You have to ask the computer, or you have to tell the computer. The old lady made the robot fast. And you'd wait. And the computer would tell you what that meant. Like, what does the old lady made the robot fast? There's different meanings of that. So it was just an exercise to see how the computer would explain what that meant. Because it could mean several things. And then there's another one where, how's this one? The boy saw the pyramid on the mountain with the telescope. And the computer would try to tell you what that meant. So the boy saw the pyramid on the mountain with the telescope. That could mean a few things. Now, you want to use perfect logic so the computer understands what you're saying. Because you want the computer to respond back to you. It's a good thing I took those classes because I kind of, in a way, used it for the... I'm talking about you, computer, even though you're turned off. But yeah, she's over there in the kitchen counter.
Different languages for different purposes. You're going to do a lot of string processing? Snowball. You want to do a lot of scientific calculations? Fortran. So different languages supported different things. When I went on to grad school, straight from college, I went to grad school in California at University of California, Irvine, in the late 80s, early 90s.
Java.
They were all Unix. Now, it wasn't that big of a jump for me because I'd been using Primos, which was a kind of a Unix.
Why would that be Unix, though? Oh, okay. Yeah, he said Irvine. Why would it be Unix, though? Yeah, where I would go to was either mainframes or the PC. The Apples were being phased out. All the other stuff was being phased out. It was mostly, they were switching over to, well, by then people realized, hey, you don't need to be a programmer to use a computer. You can just go to this computer, just go to Incredible Universe. Go to Fry's Electronics and just buy the apps you need. Or go to Computer City. Go to CompUSA. Silo. Just buy the app you need off the shelf. Maybe what happened was the computer courses were slowly dwindling away and becoming mostly web mastering, HTML. They were calling HTML a programming language. I learned to code. Well, they didn't say that. Back then they would say, I'm learning how to computer program. Oh, really? And then they would mention CSS and HTML. I was like, what? That's not programming. So nowadays, it's JavaScript, JavaScript, JavaScript. And on the other end, it's Java and Python and C++ and C#. C# is super, super famous now. In Rust, some people are saying that Rust is becoming the newcomer, but then Go snatched victory away from Rust recently. I don't know. I try to keep up with some of this stuff.
Unixy flavor, but they used real Unix. I loved it. Unix provided so many cool.
Yeah, Unix. In the 90s, before 95, I was using Unix at home. It was cool. It was great. The bee's knees. I was programming my computer to play Risk. You know, Working on a little AI, play against the computer, a game of Risk. And what else? I think I was doing RPGs still. But when 95 came out, I kicked all that stuff to the curb. It was gone. God, I wish I'd kept at least the program listings. I don't know why I threw away those program listings. I could have translated those now to Python or something.
Accessors to functionality in the OS, and it was really fun. It really supported my hacky flavors. I would do fun things like send messages to my friends and have it look like one of them, I sent them a message from God in heaven, and he replied, Satan from hell. It was funny things you could do, but one thing I really loved about it was it had features that you still don't see in a lot of modern OSs. One of them, I'll give you a quick example, how it handled files and directories. So a directory was just a collection of files, but files weren't just here's a bunch of data, oh, and we're going to label it. What files did is they pointed to what was called an internal node.
Sectors and tracks. Get out the old hex editor so you can see every byte on your hard drive.
Inode. And the inode contained all the information about here's the file, here's all the sectors that store the data, here's how they link together. The reason that was important was you could have two files.
You had to defrag. Files would be split up physically, but not logically.
In two different directories that pointed to the same inode. So they pointed to the same file, which means you open one of them and edit it, close it. When you open the other one, it's got the edits. It was like it's like Windows, what do they call it? When you make a link, a shortcut, a Windows shortcut.
Oh, a shortcut, alias.
But it's not the
same. But not the same thing.
Same, because both of those files are really the file. And what I mean by that is, edit either of them, the file gets changed. If you delete one, the other one remains. Basically, the inode knows everybody who's pointing to it. And as long as that number is greater than one, it doesn't delete the file.
Yep. What is that called? That's, man, it's been a while. It's been a while. Yeah, as long as the number's positive, it stays. But when it reaches zero, the operating system's like, oh, I guess we're not using this file anymore. We don't need it anymore. Gone. It's gone.
So if you want that file really deleted, you have to go to all the places that have that file as an inode and delete those files. What it meant was you could have, let's say you wanted to store a picture. This is something that I really wish Windows did. Let's say I had a picture, a family photo. I want to store that under Kane family. But since all my siblings are in it, I would also love that photo stored under all five siblings. Under Windows, I would have to make six copies of that photo. One for the Kane folder, and then one for each sibling folder. Or use shortcuts. But the shortcuts aren't really the file. What I love about how Unix would handle it is there would be six files of that photo, but they're all the same photo. Edit one, they're all edited. They're all edited. Try to delete it from one folder, it's not deleted from the others. It's just a really nice way of thinking of files, and it's how I thought of files, and then when I'd go back to DOS or Windows, I'd be like, ugh. By the way, speaking of back to DOS, when I went to work at Interplay in the early 90s, back to DOS.
Back to
I was at Interplay pre-Windows.
Oh, man. And
one of the things I did was...
Yeah, I can see. Going from Unix to DOS, that's a step backwards. But it's a necessary evil. DOS was a necessary evil because that's what everyone used. So if you wrote a game for DOS, you could sell a million copies of your game. If you wrote a game for Unix, good luck with that.
When I wrote GNOL, and I've got a whole video about GNOL, I made a wrapper for all the stuff I wanted to do in DOS, including some things that I built on top of DOS, like pop-up windows and things. And then I just said, that's...
Yeah, you have your little sidekick thing. You always have sidekick or something that your game could make calls to, like a library sort of thing. It was... what was that called? It was memory. It was in RAM. What was it called? It was always in RAM. So you had to have more than 640K or whatever to even use the stupid thing. But there were programs like that. What was it called? It would use a certain... It was a certain kind of app. There was a certain kind of name for it. Memory resident something... Resident memory. Anyway. Kind of a cool feature. As long as the program was small, you could have it in there. And then your game would just use it. You could use it for a GUI for your game and stuff like that.
Oh, I'm going to code for GNOME. So someone else could write the Windows version, and someone did. And someone else could write the Mac version, and someone did. But we were just coding Fallout in GNOME, and it worked on all those other ones. And I really like that. Also, a lot of the early computers that Interplay bought to do rendering on were Sun computers. And they ran Irix, which was a very, very strongly flavored version of Unix. And I knew Unix. So I was often brought in when the 3D artists had a problem, like, hey, I can't get this to work, or I'm shut out of my account or whatever. I would go in and fix that. So while I was coding, technically, for DOS and Windows, I was doing my own stuff for GNOME and occasionally going in and do Unix stuff. Now, why did I make all that GNOME stuff? Because Windows ain't great.
Nope.
I'm not going to sit here and defend Windows. Sometimes it's really hard to use it, and it's really hard to code for. But I would tell you two nice things about it is, like DOS, if you can conceive of what you want to do, you can probably do it under Windows.
Yeah.
And tons of backward compatibility.
Yes.
I am still playing games from 30 years ago
exactly.
on Windows.
Exactly.
I can't do that with Apple. Let me talk about that. I only made one game for the Apple, and that was Fallout. And I really didn't make it for...
Oh, I remember, that. Yeah.
I made it for GNOME and GNOME.
I remember, yeah, there was an Apple version of Fallout. I remember that. I was thinking, I should probably buy this for my dad. But he had a different Mac. And it would not run. I don't think it would run on his Mac, because the Mac changed. You know, we're going to go with a different processor. We're going to go with a different operating system. We're going to use Operation Butthead Astronomer. We're going with that going forward. We're using that for our secret operating system. And I was like, God damn it. In the old days, the old days of DOS, it would say you need DOS 3.5 to run this program. So you're typing ver on your computer to see what version of DOS it has. Oh, I've only got 2.9 or something. Oh, God damn it. All right. But now, there's still DOS on these Windows computers. Every time you update your Windows, it updates the DOS just a little. They say Windows 11, but it's still Windows 10 that we're using. I don't know why. I don't know why they didn't change it to Windows 10. I think Windows 10, it's going to be Windows 10 permanently. But marketing is going to call it Windows 11, Windows 12, Windows 13. But when you look under the hood, it's still going to be Windows 10, I bet you.
It all had a Mac OS version. The reason for that is, in my career, I haven't seen that Apple really cares in any way about games. They're there. They recognize them.
They're there.
They occasionally make a half...
You would go to B. Dalton, and there'd be a little section of software. You know, there'd be... Apple programs and programs for the PC and something for a Commodore 64. I'd wait till the stuff goes on clearance and I'd buy it and stuff. And but yeah, everywhere you would go back then, the PC shelves would take up a good 5 or 6 sections. a section being, what, 4 feet wide? And the max section would just be one section, or maybe half of one section. It was weird. It was like, you know, people would say to me, Shunner, you know the Mac is better with graphics than the Windows, right? And they're both running Photoshop, you know. All this PageMaker, Quark Express, Illustrator, you know, those programs ran on both Mac and IBM. So you couldn't say one was better at graphics than the other. You just could not.
Half-hearted effort like Game Sprockets, which then disappears, but they don't really care about them. It's not, I can't see that being part of a board meeting going, how do we expand our game stuff?
No, they wanted to write, the Mac is mostly about iPhoto, iPage, iWrite, iMusic, you know, the notepad, the clock, the calculator, those kinds of things. That's what the Mac people want to use when they turn on their Mac for some reason.
Yeah, because of iPhone, there's a lot of Apple games now, but I don't really think they care about that. And one of the problems is everything has to be done Apple's way.
Yes.
And if you don't do it their way, screw you. So yes. Sometimes you can't even do it. When we made Fallout, we had to process art files, and yep. We had thousands of them, yep. And they were processed separately for Windows and PC.
Although I think
DOS
and Windows. And you use JPEG, and that's JPEG is a patent copyright format that Apple hasn't agreed to yet. Bah, bah,
bah. Processed the same, and then they were processed separately for Mac. Well, guess what? For Windows, we wrote a simple batch file that simply said, go into this folder, grab star dot, whatever the extension was for the art files, and process them through this other application that had a console version.
New. The only thing the Mac is good for is dragging stuff to the garbage can and thinking, that's that, it's gone. Yeah, it's still there.
Whoa. Doing that on the Mac was a pain in the butt. I think we needed to do a third-party batch file system and find something that accepted commands being given to it. The biggest thing I remember was, this is in the mid-90s, you couldn't rope. I mean, if you wanted to collect a bunch of files, you had to rope them, you know, where you slid the mouse over it and grabbed them all. It wouldn't rope thousands. It stopped after, I think, 256. So you had to rope them in chunks, even from the same directory.
Okay, StarCraft. I want to rope all my armies and go after, you know. Nope, you can only rope like 8 units at a time or something. You can't just control select all, you know. No, you only get to select 8 units at a time in StarCraft. So much micromanaging.
The Mac guy started complaining that we had 1,000 folders in one directory, and I said they all belong there. They're all one thing. These are all the art files associated for a map. And he was like, no, you shouldn't put more than 206. I'm like,
ugh. they still had a limit? I know the file names had a limit. But there was actually a limit on the number of files in a folder? Is that a thing? Thank you, Steve Jobs. Thank you so much.
Oh, by the way, just the very beginning of Apple people love to tell you if it's not something Apple supports that you're doing it wrong. And it's a weird thing.
It's a religion.
iPhone couldn't send a text to multiple recipients. A friend of mine who's a big Apple guy told me that wasn't a big deal, even though he was on my weekly dinner text that I sent out in the evening going, hey, where are we going to go eat? And I couldn't send those. There were like 12 people on that. He said, we'll send them individually. And I'm like, and when one person responds, hey, I don't want to do pizza this week, can we switch to, you know, Chinese?
Yeah, no one sees that because it went just to you. Just to you.
Is there something? And I was like, I'm not sending 12 messages out. And when one person has a change, taking that and resending it out to 12, I said, I'd rather just not be in charge of this anymore. And it was stupid because Android did support that from the very beginning. It was a weird, it's a weird fanaticism.
What about BlackBerry? BlackBerry was good at that, right? Right.
And it just drives me bonkers. Anyway, that fall, after Fallout, I didn't do anything on Apple anymore. So I don't really know what it's like to code on there. I know people like
Swift. It used to be Objective-C. Now it's Swift. Hey, so, well, that explains why there was no Fallout 2. Gosh. For the Macintosh.
Using it, and I get why they do. It's a very consistent interface. It's very easy to use. Easier than Windows. But I think what I can tell you, I will sum up. After 4 decades, Windows won. It just won.
It just did.
I used it the most in my career. It still is probably what I would use the most. It has the most games for it, especially if you include Xbox.
It works with old DOS games. It just works.
If I was going to pick a runner-up, it still wouldn't be macOS. It would probably be Unix or some flavor of it, Linux or something like that. It's what's in the Steam Deck. You can run Windows games under Linux. So I'd probably pick that as my runner-up. But right now, if you want to be a programmer and you want the most options on where to work and what games to work on, I think you got to go Windows as your OS. I'm sure people will disagree. I'd love.
Yeah, here's the thing, though. People aren't buying PCs anymore, so that's the problem. That's a huge problem. People just have phones. That's it. Or they have a Chromebook. I don't know if my die rollers and character generators can even work on a Chromebook. I have no idea. I just say, hey, this has been tested on Windows 10 and Windows 11. That's it. People will rewrite some of my stuff for Linux. Someone rewrote one of my apps for a Mac, but I'm sure it's outdated by now because the Mac changes. You know, every time they release an OS, it breaks the stuff.
Love to hear the reasons why, but those are my reasons why. And anyway, I hope this answered your question, Rami Obama.
That was neat.